Okay, so here I am at the remote computer with graphical browser, and I'll be typing commands in on this shell here. So it's basically the same setup. If you saw my Linux and Scratch 1.0 videos, I've got a box which I'm using as a web server to provide me with the book, mainly because the internet can be a little bit unreliable here. So it's just convenient to have that on tap and know it'll work. And secondly, the Linux and Scratch 1.0 hasn't got any method of access apart from Telnet. We built a Telnet daemon server to run, but I haven't got any PCs apart from this PPro 200 that's got a Telnet client on it, and I don't particularly want to install that on any of them anyway. So it's convenient from that point of view in that I'll SSH into that box, into this PPro 200 box, and then from there Telnet into the Pentium 233MMX, where we'll be building Linux from scratch 4.0. So it's a bit convoluted, but it kind of works all right. And if there was open SSH installed on Linux from scratch 1.0, it would probably be too out of date to allow any connections anyway, so it's kind of convenient, despite the fact that it's a bit long-winded. One thing I will mention before we actually get stuck into building Linux from scratch is the live CD, if you want to download an image and take a look at it. This is the link here, www.linuxfromscratch.org. /live CD. I'm not sure if you can directly access this from the home page. If I click from here, you can see the menus aren't there. So whether there is a link into that page or not somewhere on this main live website, if you like, I don't know. But if it is hidden, I don't know if it is, you can certainly still get to it by typing that live CD in. It gives you some information there. If you click on download, it gives you some links of some mirrors that where you can download it. There is no active BitTorrent available. I haven't tried this repository. I assume it's still there, but I don't know. Like I said, I haven't tried it. It might not be actually. It looks like it's using SVN. I'm pretty sure they use Git now, though. I believe Git can provide SVN access, so I'm not sure about that. But I this morning took a look at this first link here, and that one's certainly working. That's interesting. It was certainly working this morning when I looked. Okay, well, that one's working. So if you see here, there's various versions and so on. There's a 6.2 version, but it's for PPC architecture, so you probably don't want to touch that one. But then the earliest one for 32-bit Intel is this one here, 6.2. Looks like there's three versions of that. And then the bulk of the versions are 6.3, which is obviously like the only version or final version they did, by the looks of it. Be careful, because there are some 64-bit images here, so they obviously won't work on the Pentium 233. The one that I booted from was this last 32-bit version, this R2145. So, and it looks like there's one there that hasn't got the source packages on as well. So you probably want to download the bigger one of the two of them. Looks like there's a minimum one there. I don't know quite what the difference is of that, but maybe that is just purely a text layout, and maybe this other one's got a graphical interface. I don't know. I've never tried that. But yeah, the 2145 is what I booted, so I know that works. So that's that. So really, all I need to do is to crack on with starting to build Linux from scratch 4.0. So as you can see, this is dated 2002. I believe it's sometime in, let's have a look, jump into here, it says your date. October 2002. So this Pentium 233 is roughly 97, 98, so it's about 4 years old, the hardware, compared to the book version. But as I say, it's still not too old that it's going to be taking too long or a great deal of time to build. As I say, I haven't got any hardware that's newer than the Pentium but older than this book to make it an authentic build. I didn't want to build on a machine that's too new and, well, make it not authentic, but possibly even have problems in maybe hardware that I couldn't access because the software could support it. So that's that. So let's just flick through the beginning of the book. You'll see as you go through, if you know the more recent versions of Linux from scratch, that the layout's starting to become a bit more familiar. It's looking a little bit more professional than version 1.0 did. So just the usual background information at the beginning of the book. I'm not going to sort of dwell on this too long. I presume you're only going to be building or wanted to build or have an interest in building older versions if you're happy with building the more modern versions. So we've got a changelog there with all the packages. The biggest problem I had wasn't getting the packages. That was fairly easy to get the packages. The hardest problem was there's no record of the patches that are required for version 4.0. Now, in version 4.1, all the patches were either commands that you basically modified the packages yourself manually, or they may have been some sort of text to modify another bit of text or configuration that you just copied and pasted in. There's no actual patches as such. At some point between 1 and 4, version 1 and 4, patches are starting to be created. As I say, there's no record of this. Nobody's published either the packages or the patches. So that was the hardest part. And what it turned out was I've had to pinch a few patches from LFS version 5 and adapt them. But most of the patches I've had to recreate myself or ignore the packages and hope that it didn't cause any problems. So you might see there's a patch it says to fix a bug, but it doesn't really describe what the bug is, so I don't know what the patch would be anyway. And if I did, I probably wouldn't be able to fix it. I don't know anything about C. So all the patches you see that I've created are just based on what the description is in the book and my very minimal knowledge of being able to emulate that. But those patches that I've either put together or stolen, or maybe I've gone on the internet with the problem that's come up and copied and pasted somebody else's patch, they all do work. They all do allow us to ultimately build version 4.0. Another problem I've had is presumably because of such a big jump from 1 to 4, so it is a big jump in terms of version number. It's not that a big jump in terms of time because Linux from scratch was dated December 1999. This is October 2002. It's only 2 years or so, not even 2 years. 3 years almost. So it's quite a while, but there's not as many changes back then as there is today. There seems to be more updates. So and also I think there was less, there was less inclination to make current software compatible with older software. I think with modern software there's more of an effort to make current software compatible with older software, and if that's not able to be done, then it's normally announced and there's a major upgrade in version numbers, so that, you know, everybody's aware that there are incompatibilities. So it's a bit of a different environment, I think, or different way of thinking about things in terms of updating software, maybe not so much testing or checking on how things will work if things are modified. Talking testing, there's still no tests done on the packages, so you are effectively building blind and hoping that what you build will work later on down the line. One other thing I should mention is that by default, the Linux from scratch 1.0 isn't really in a state to replicate itself. So although, yes, it is a finished product and you can do stuff with it, it's not complete, in my opinion, as a Linux from scratch build, in that you wouldn't be able to replicate itself, or indeed what I'm going to do, version 4.0. There's still a few tweaks and minor changes that need to be done to get things to work. But then, you know, bear in mind that was the first version that Jared Beekman's had built, and, you know, it's still a great product that he's put together and, you know, been generous enough to give us the instructions of how he did that. So it's in no way demeaning what he's done. It's just that, you know, he's obviously still a bit of a novice at the time. And, you know, especially with hindsight, you can see now using that, it still needs some changes to be made. So what I'm going to do, first of all, before we carry on, is get into the machine. So first I need to get into the server that I'll be using. So this is the server that's providing the web pages and as a node to jump over, to leapfrog into the Pentium machine. So I need to do telnet into the Pentium machine, which, if you recall, is the same IP address before as it was on Linux from scratch 1.0. It's that one there. And I'll just log in as root, and we're in there. So if I do uname minus A, and you can see the host name's LFS 1.0, Linux kernel version's 2.2.1.3. And you can see when it was built, that's when the recordings would have been. And if I do a df minus h, you can see there's that HDA7 that I've just generated, or just created and formatted. And you can see there's the 1.7 gigabytes of space we've got available. So I'm going to actually unmount that, because as you can see on the instructions, we'll be mounting that in MNT LFS, which is the usual place to build a Linux from scratch partition, although it's not compulsory to put it in that place, it's obviously convention. So I'll unmount that, and I'll do that export command. In fact, let's copy and paste it in. And in fact, what I'm going to do is I'm going to edit the bash profile, I think is the one I need to do, and put that in so that every time I log in as root, that variable will be there, and it just means that I won't have to remember all the time to make sure that's set. So if I log out now, log back in again, and do echo LFS. Okay, wasn't my profile. All right, it should be dot bash profile, that's why. So I need to do move bash profile into dot bash underscore profile. And let's log out once more and log back in again. And that's better, that's set now. So the next thing I'm going to do before I move on is, one thing that hasn't been set is that the temp directory hasn't got the correct permissions on it. As you can see, it's just got the usual 755 permissions on there, so everybody can read, write and execute from the temp directory, but only the root, only the root, and well, everybody else can only read from it, not write from it. No, let's say that again. Only the root can read and write to the temp directory. Everybody else can only read from the temporary directory. Now, as we're going to be setting up an LFS user again, that's no good, because the LFS user will need write access to the temp directory. So what we've got to do is a command that you'll see in every later Linux from scratch books. And if you check, probably I guess nearly every single Linux on scratch distribution. They've got these permissions set on temp, so it's 177. So the one I believe is to make the directory sticky, and the 777 is to give read write access to everybody on temp. So now if I do list temp, you can see, I think that's the sticky bit, that T off the top of my head. You can see everybody's got, well, the root's still got read, write, and execute. Everybody in the root group has got read, write, access, and everybody else who isn't root or in the root group has also got read, write, access, but also the sticky bit has been set. So that means the any user will have that permission to delete any file they've created, but not anybody else's that's in the temp directory. So we've created the file system on the HDA7. So what I'm going to do now is to mount HDA7 in the place that we really want it, which is in LFS. Okay, we haven't created LFS yet, so let's make that. Does it actually tell us about this? Let's just read this here. Please read the following. LFS must be set at all times. If you plan to use LFS, do not forget to set the LFS for all times. If RL is not set and used in a command like this. Oh yeah, so it's warning you that if you don't set LFS, a command like this will recreate the etc password file, and basically it'll destroy it. It'll overwrite it with the new version. So then it suggests putting it in the bash rc file there. Bash profile and bash rc. So let's do that as well before we move on. So let's do a copy dot bash profile to dot bash rc. You can see the keyboard's still not configured correctly in Linux from scratch 1.0, and as we progress through the Linux from scratches, I imagine they will be set up with more functionality. Okay, so that's done. So let's move on. Something there about static bash units as usual, where to get the software from, how to install it. So all this is pretty standard now. And you can see this looks all quite familiar. So the text might have changed slightly, but the actual purpose of it is still in the latest. So here's a list of all the links. You can see they're from the Linux from Scratch website, but they don't exist anymore. So they're basically useless, these links now. Same with the patches. The patches aren't available, as I've already mentioned. So create a new partition. We've done that. We've formatted partition. Right, okay, so we've just done this. We've mounted it, I think, have we? No, we haven't mounted it, so let's mount it now. Let's copy that. Put in HDA7. Let's use our variable to make sure it works. Okay, we didn't. Oh, right, okay, I thought we had created it. That's why I paused, so that we could create it. Right, so that's now existing, and that would work. Df-h, so there it is back again, but this time on MNT LFS. It tells you if you're doing multiple partitions. The only multiple partition we'll be using is the boot partition, just to keep things a little bit more simple. So preparing the LFS system. Okay, suggest a check that we've got LFS set. Well, we know we have because we just used it, but there's never any harm to check. Some information there about static linking, when it's used and when it's not used. So basically, with this version of Linux from Scratch, everything that's built for the construction part of Linux from Scratch, so the pre-build, if you like, is built in a static way, but then the final LFS system is built in a dynamic way, so all the libraries are shared. And say those pages explain why that is. So for this first bit, before we get into the true environment, we build everything as an unprivileged user to try and avoid breaking anything with the host system. So you'll notice with this version still, the double ampersand is used to chain commands together, a bit like BLFS does. And this obviously gets dropped later on in Linux and Scratch, just so you can see what each command is doing. The idea is obviously that you type in each command and understand what each command does. So let's set a password for the LFS user. Then we need to give proper permissions to the static directory. So let's do that. Now you can log in as user LFS. You can do this two ways, either normal way through the console or display manager, or use SU LFS. When you're working with the user LFS, type the following commands to set up the environment. So let's log in like that. So we're now the LFS user, and we want to copy all of this in. In fact, let's do the here doc first, and then we source that bash profile script, and I'm actually going to make an extra change to that. I'm going to add in a change to the prompt, because the prompt's pretty useless at the moment. I can't see what directory I'm in, so I'd have to be typing PWD all the time, so it's potentially dangerous. I can't just glance to see where I am. So I'm just going to add an export PS1 to change the prompt, the standard prompt. Equals quote / u to show what user I'm at, currently logged in as, at the host name, the current working directory, and the $ to show that I'm the standard user. And I'll save that. So now if I rerun the source command, you can see I'm LFS at. Okay, the host name is actually LFS1.0, but it seems Bash ignores everything after the one, so that's quite interesting. But yes, anyway, you can see it's kind of shown the host and the working directory you can see there. So if I change into temp, for example, it's updated the prompt, so that's all good. One thing I need to also do is to fetch the sources. So that's not mentioned in here specifically. You can see the next bit, it goes on to Bash. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to log out back to the root, change into LFS, and I'm going to make a sources directory, change the ownership of that to LFS. Okay, we haven't got an LFS group. That's not a problem. We'll just ignore that. As long as the LFS user can go in there and change stuff. And then I'm going to change... What I should do, actually, is to check the swap. I didn't create a bigger swap directory, actually, but it's not a problem. Right, we've got a swap partition active, so that's okay. I don't think should be using any more than that 128 meg plus the 64 meg of main memory. So that should be all right. What I need to do is to become the Linux from scratch user, change into LFS sources, and I need to fetch the packages and patches now. So what I'm going to do is to use links to go to the server, the web server, which is also a file server, but I'm going to access this through the web browser to get the files. So this will be LFS 4.0/, that should be enough there, I think. Okay, so I need to. So obviously, the terminal at the moment. Let's see what it is. Is set to that, and it looks like the host doesn't recognize that, or Lynx doesn't recognize that terminal name. So I need to do term equals X term and then Lynx ppro 200 /LFS-4.0. So I'm pretty sure it's that error is caused by Lynx not recognizing that terminal string. Right, what's that done there? Okay, why is that not working? Let's try an IP address. Maybe the DNS is not working. Not 37, 30. Yep, that's better. So it looks like DNS is working. I must admit, I had problems getting the DNS working on version 4.0, so I don't know if that's an omission or some configuration problem that I couldn't fathom out, but the main thing was that I could get access internally. So if you're going to download these packages, and I will make them available, as I did with the packages for Linux from scratch 1.0, you'd probably have to work out another way to get them onto the machine that you're going to be building on. Maybe it's a USB plug or something like that, or another disk or a floppy or something or other. So I've got the packages archived here, and I'm hoping that this version of Linux from scratch, version 1, will be able to extract these. Otherwise, I'll have to maybe download them individually. But let's see if this works. Just wait for that to download. So okay, I don't suppose it'll be much faster than that because it's only over 100 megabit link. Okay, looks well, let's run and see what else there is to do. No, it doesn't look like it. All we've got to do is extract that and then proceed with bash when this is finished downloading. Okay, so that's downloaded. Let's now save it now. So press enter. Keep the file name. So that's just copying it from its temporary location to the current directory we're in. Maybe these old disks are quite slow. So now I'm going to press Q to quit that. Yes. And when the prompt returns, you can see we've got a... Okay, this is no human readable format. Let's try K. Yeah, that works. Yeah, so it's about, 150 odd megabytes by the looks of it. So let's try and extract that. XZ. Okay, yeah, that's working. That's good. I didn't know if because I gzipped that on the server, which is a newer version of both tar and gzip, I didn't know if they're being compatible with this older version that we're using from 1999 effectively. So this tarball I will make available for you to download. I'll publish it sometime after I've published the videos, or around the same time. One thing you will notice, there's a couple of extra files in there that aren't actually, there's several files actually that aren't used. There's two extra files in there that aren't used at all in the Linux from Scratch 4.0 book. And one of them's gcc-3.2.tar.whatever it is. I'll show you which one it is. It's that one there. That's the complete GCC tarball. And in the Linux from Scratch 4.0, we only actually use the core and G++, but we don't use anything else within GCC. So I've kept that there for completeness. But in actual fact, you'll see me only using these two packages here. The other file that isn't used is the test suite. As I say, there's no tests run. And in fact, what I'll do is I'll delete these just to prove a point that they're not used. That one there and the test suite. So they're the only two that aren't used at all. They're purely for completeness. And you'll notice there are some other files that aren't in the LFS 4.0 book, but I've had to include them just to get LFS 4.0 built. So for example, the first one you can see is there's two versions of Bash. And the reason is that the later version, this 205A, which is the correct version for Linux from Scratch 4.0, won't actually build with the GCC versions that are included in Linux from Scratch version 1.0. So if you remember from Linux from Scratch 1.0, we've got GCC 2.9.5.2, and we also had an older version, 2.7.2.3. Which was used, I can't remember the exact reason now. I think it was some packages wouldn't be built with the newer version. So neither of those versions are able to build Bash 2.05a. So what I do is I build 2.04, which can be built with 2.95.2. And because it's only in the static part of it, you know, the construction site, if you like, that doesn't cause a problem. But when we come to actually build the final Linux from Scratch system, I do use the correct version and it does build okay and so on. So there's one or two, I think, like that or similar. I can't actually see any now. But there's some little hacks I've had to do. Oh, yeah, NCurse is there as well. It looks like there's another one. There's two different versions there. You know, the later one wouldn't build for some reason, so I've had to use the previous version to get by. So that's why there's extra packages in there. So the packages here are complete insofar as version 4.0 is concerned, but there are one or two extra packages, such as NCurses and Bash, purely to enable the transition from Linux from scratch 1.0 to Linux from scratch 4.0. But all the packages in the final system are the correct versions for Linux from scratch 4.0. So in theory, at the end of it, we should have a correct Linux from scratch 4.0 with all the correct versions and all working fine. So last thing I want to do before we start building is to do an MD5 sum check. I've included an MD5 sums file there just to verify that those files are okay. Yeah, you're going to get two failures now because I've just deleted those other two files, but that's not a problem. As I say, they're not going to be used. They're just there for completeness. So, yeah, apart from those two, everything else is okay. So, I think we're in a position to actually start building.